we have here an intersection between what we do in quantum and the classical world. What I'm going to present will be some joint work that I have done with several of my collaborators here at DEI, at IIT Delhi, and at CIU Kiel. Saulen is a PhD student in Kiel, and Professor Srivastav is my collaborator. Similarly, Swanti Gupta is a PhD student who's working at IIT Delhi but registered here at DEI with us. Apoor Narayan is here. He started his quantum-inspired evolutionary algorithms here, and I'm glad to see that he's continuing that at Waterloo. And the others are PG and PhD students at DEI. A quick recap of what optimization is all about. You have a function that you want to optimize, and typically the search space could be very large, and you want to find a particular binary vector, a real vector, a tree, a neural network, whatever, which gives you the optimal value for this function. So we'll be talking about some combinatorial optimization problems as well as real parameter function optimization problems in this talk. We have math programming techniques which have been established for quite a long time, and the main issue that arose when problems started becoming more complicated and we started becoming more ambitious, trying to solve larger and larger problems with better computers, is to whether we want to solve a simplified problem exactly or solve exact problem approximately. The first approach is the math programming approach, and modern heuristics talk about the second alternative. With more computation, the solution can typically be brought closer to the exact solution. And one of the most prominent approaches in this is the approach of genetic algorithms. Here, they try to mimic nature. You have a population of individuals which form the parent set, combine with each other through crossover and mutation, produce children. You find out which children are more effective than the others according to your chosen criterion, and then give them a higher probability of participating in producing more children in the next generation, just as evolution does. And going through this iterative process, you can do the optimization. The basic steps are sufficient. These steps are sufficient, and that's what nature has essentially been doing and has managed to evolve what we believe intelligent species, that's us. But for optimization problems in engineering and other real world applications, this could be pretty slow. In evolutionary algorithms, there are two aspects. One is exploration and the other is exploitation. In exploration, we ensure that no region of the search space is left out. In exploitation, we ensure that whatever regions we are visiting, we don't miss out on any good individual. But the problem is we want to visit all the regions, and in all the regions, we want to look at all the solutions. So these are mutually conflicting requirements. The computational requirements will become very, very large if we try to, it will boil down to exhaustive search, which is combinatorial. Therefore, AI design is more an art. The fundamental problem in evolutionary algorithms is that each solution has only one chance to prove itself. Otherwise, it gets knocked out when you select only the fitter amongst the children to become parents in the next generation. But children are produced by exchanging gene material through probabilistic operators. So it can happen that one or two genes are misplaced, and therefore your good, potentially good solution gets knocked out after the evolution process. A solution to this is to handle this problem through estimation of distribution algorithms. In estimation of distribution algorithms, you don't do this kind of knocking out. You try to estimate the distribution of the good solutions through a probabilistic model and avoid the disruptive effects of the operators. This is the EDA framework. You have a population and parent set just like what you had earlier, but now here you have a probabilistic model instead of operators to produce the children. And through the model, you produce new children for the next generation. And this probabilistic model keeps getting updated according to your experience with the evolution process. So quantum-inspired evolutionary algorithms are having some characteristics of evolutionary algorithms, some of EDAs, and some are quantum-inspired. So let's see, what are they? They are basically population-based probabilistic EAs, borrowing concepts from quantum computing for higher representation power and search, but they are computationally less expensive because search can be carried out with less population sizes. And also they can be modeled as multimodal EDAs. So it's a pretty growing field, and if you do a Google Scholar search just with these words, quantum evolutionary algorithms, you get more than 20,000 results. And around 4,000 of them are just in 2011. So this is pretty new and growing. And what's that? You have a merger of quantum computing and evolutionary algorithms, but what you are getting is a classical algorithm. You can run it on your digital computer. It's not for a quantum computer, and that's one of its advantages. While we are waiting for quantum computers that can handle real world engineering problems to be developed, we can still use ideas from quantum. So what is it that we are doing there? They are still population based. We are employing observation and qubit strings and quantum operators instead of the genetic operators. Single qubit string is sometimes enough, even for large problems. Solution strings of subsequent iterations maintain an indirect link through a qubit string. So this is how you represent the individual by a set of qubits. To this audience, this is pretty familiar. Now, observation is what you could rather call collapse. We call it observation because we're not getting rid of the quantum bit. We're continuing with the existing values. Updating the qubit string is by rotation operators. We rotate the qubits towards better solutions. That's where implicitly we are maintaining the model. Links for those from theoretical computer science background can also be found to randomized rounding. This is similar to what we do in randomized rounding. But the difference is that in randomized rounding, you have these k independent trials. Whereas in case of QEA, it's a sequence of randomized roundings favoring probability distributions that encourage search towards the best solution found so far. So you're marrying ideas from randomized rounding and greedy search, and the hope is that you're getting the right amount of randomness. That's through implementation, better implementation ideas. So this is how a QEA works. The exploration of the search space is driven by attractors corresponding to the best solution that you found so far, either at the individual, local, or at the global level. If a non-optimal solution is propagated to global level, then this solution starts to attract the entire population. So all probabilistic models would converge towards this global attractor, and the probabilistic model becomes unable to produce solutions different from the attractor. Therefore, bad choice of an attractor can quickly become irreversible. So we have to be careful about that in our implementation. This is the model. You start with some individuals which you collapse to find some children, find out the best among them, make them the attractors for the local population, find out the best among them, make them the attractors for the group, and out of all the groups, select the best to make it the global attractor. And this iterative process continues at these various levels. I'm showing these various levels because it shows automatically the parallelization that you can build into the implementation. With these days you have all multi-core architectures, and inherently this whole idea is parallelizable. And I'll show you some results about that. So we enhanced this using some extra operators, which we call neighborhood operator 1 and neighborhood operator 2. And we've used ideas like that for different problems. I'll just present two cases to you. One is discrepancy of two colorings of hypergraphs of arithmetic progressions. A hypergraph is different from a graph in the sense that the edges are any subset of the 2 to the v vertices. Not just two vertices, but 2 to the v vertices. So like here, now this is a hyperedge, a collection of 4 vertices. Any collection of vertices could be an hyperedge. So in a graph, there will be 2 to the n hyperedges. And if you are taking hypergraphs of arithmetic progressions, what essentially you're doing is that you are taking different values of a, I, and d in the arithmetic progression. And then the an is the hypergraph of arithmetic progressions, where you are taking an intersection between n and all the elements in the progressions. So the number of hyperedges although we are saying that we are taking all combinations, it's not n cube, because you can take each one of the n values from 1 to n for each one of these. But it turns out, and we've shown that the number of hyperedges is n square log n and not n cube. Even n square log n is a pretty large number. Now we can color each vertices minus 1 and 1, or red or blue, or whatever you choose to. And the imbalance of the two colors in each hyperedge is the discrepancy of that hyperedge. The discrepancy of the complete graph is the discrepancy of the edge with maximum discrepancy. You want to color the graph in such a way that this maximum discrepancy is minimized. So that's the optimization problem that we are attacking. Note that there could be n square log n hyperedges. So if you're talking about, say, a graph of 10,000 vertices, you're already talking about a graph having more than 1 billion edges. So we'll be presenting results for graphs much larger than even that. This has got a long history because of its importance in different applications. So lower bound of n to the 1/4 was given by Roth in 64, and this was also shown to be a tight upper bound in 1994 by Matusik and Spencer. But then the algorithmically fundamental problem of computing a solution which gives you this bound was not solved. This problem we have taken up because it possesses all the structural properties which make computation of a low discrepancy coloring a hard problem. Basic challenge is the size itself, as I mentioned. When you're talking about a graph with 10,000 vertices, you have more than 1 billion edges. So it can serve as a challenging benchmark problem, and we can see how to use quantum evolutionary algorithms to do this. We start with a probabilistic half-half coloring. That means we just flip a fair coin and decide on the color based on the result. And this upper bound for the discrepancy can easily be obtained by using a simple probabilistic method like this. Sarkozy's algorithm runs in polynomial time and gives you a discrepancy of at most n log n to the 1 by 3. Note that the bound is n to the 1 by 4. So we can still reduce this. But for 35 years, this algorithm was the algorithm with best performance. So what we do in our parallel quantum evolutionary algorithms is that we start with a good Sarkozy coloring. We don't even know whether that's the very best or we can further improve it. We try it. And we improve it with a parallel message passing interface implementation of QEE using up to 96 processes. And we design local operators to aid the search. To keep the comparison fair, what we've done is we have given the same amount of computation time to each method. So for example, we also implemented a randomized rounding method and gave it the same computation time. Tn is the computation time given in seconds. Now, and also we used Sarkozy coloring and improved it using randomized rounding, and this is the kind of results that we get. For 20,000, we get a discrepancy of 50. The best solution we got had a discrepancy of 50. Whereas for randomized rounding, after randomized rounding, 20,000, you get a discrepancy of 45. With QEA, with migration between them, using 96 processes, we could reduce that to 43. But that's not all. What you see is that with 25% of the computation time, we are already at 43 for 20,000. And similar results are there for others. We are reaching the optimal solution much quicker in 1/4 the computation time. Then we got greedy. We said maybe we can do it with less number of processes. Why have 96 processes? And we saw, yes, we could get the same solution with just 16 processes. Then we got even more greedy. We said maybe quantum is not required. Maybe just the genetic algorithm is sufficient for solving this problem. But that's not true. The classical EA with 16 processes gets me to only 48, not the best solution that we obtained with quantum evolution. So there is a role that quantum representation and quantum search power is providing to this problem. Then we checked whether the solutions that we are obtaining are at least locally optimal. We can't check for global optimality because of the sheer size of the problem. So we looked for local optimality, and yes, we did find that under all these changes, our solution is still optimal. So it motivates a closer look at Roth's computation of the lower bound constant and the upper bound constant. Somewhere there is a gap that has to be reduced. So that's the graphical representation. These are the kind of solutions we are finding for different graphs. So, and this is what I emphasized, we are dealing with graphs of size 10 to the 10 hyperedges. That's a huge data structure. Just as an aside, apart from the presentation, this is now an area that's really becoming big, at least in Germany. US is yet to catch up on this. It started in Germany, algorithm engineering, in the sense that in theoretical computer science and practitioners have been always considered to be apart. These people were interested in bounds and these people were interested in getting the results. Now what algorithm engineering says is that time has come when the practitioners have to learn from theory and the theory has to be improved based on practice. So that's the loop that is getting completed. This is from Peter Sanders, the chair of algorithm engineering priority program in Germany. And this is a beautiful representation of what you are actually doing there. Design, analysis, implementation, experiments, changing the design, and that's the loop. With realistic models, you can get algorithm libraries which will give you access to more applications. That's the idea of algorithm engineering, and we have started a group here. Next year, we hope to have an Indo-German conclave here on algorithm engineering. So the second part is a real parameter optimization problem, where we are doing systemic studies on large-scale natural systems, where we have developed an efficient quantum evolutionary algorithm for marine CO2 simulation. This is an interesting problem, as well as a very important problem for our environmental sake. So we're studying oceanic carbon dioxide uptake. This is under a project called as Future Ocean Cluster at Kiel, where I have been visiting every summer for the past 3 years. And the idea is that the ocean is helping us absorb a lot of carbon dioxide. So we want to model that, and we want to see how to reduce the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere and what can be done to reduce it. So we look for tracers. What they have done is they have put sensors in the ocean at several places, and they have a huge data. The ocean people have developed a model using a set of partial differential equations. And our problem as computer science people was to do a parameter estimation for this problem. The parameter estimation problem is a very computationally intensive problem. So we developed a parallel quantum evolutionary algorithm for this purpose, again using MPI cluster implementation. And since that's not enough, we merged automatic differentiation and local search along with that, developed within the Future Ocean Cluster by Professor Thomas Slavik. And the main observation was that we were frequently converging to the same value of optimum. Another group in England was also doing the same computation task. And the good thing about our quantum-inspired evolutionary algorithm, they were using a different technique, traditional math techniques, that they were converging to the same solution in a weeks of computation time, where we were doing it within 24 hours, the same solution. But then this solution was insufficient because it was several standard deviations away from the measured data. You're doing parameter estimation so that you can fit the model well and you can do an extrapolation to predict the future. But here we are still several standard deviations away from the measured data. But repeated experimentation by two different groups giving you the same optimal solution suggests that the model itself is insufficient and has to be revised and extended. So this is what now the ocean people are doing. They are trying to look at what is the shortcoming in the model that the parameter estimations are not becoming as accurate as we want them to be. So this is the significance of our contribution, that extensions are needed and our computational work is easily adaptable for this extension. Then there are some other problems that we have attempted using the similar ideas. I don't have the time to go into the details, so I'll just give you a bird's eye view of the kind of problems that you can use quantum evolutionary algorithms for. Another combinatorial optimization problem is a quadratic knapsack problem, again with huge number of applications in different areas. And it's an NP-hard problem. So you have to look for good heuristics. Applications vary from finance, VLSI design, interstation, traffic, so on. So here what we do is we start with a greedy solution. The good thing about these algorithms is that if you have a good heuristic, you can start with that. It's not us versus them. It's not their heuristic versus our heuristic. It always pays to merge different heuristics, get the best performance by combining different ideas. That's the message that I would like to convey to the young friends here who would want to try this. And these are some of the places where we have results published on quantum knapsack problem. Then there are interesting problems in power systems. Some people from power might be here, like economic load dispatch, economic emission dispatch, dynamic economic dispatch, unit commitment. All these problems are characterized by heavily nonlinear objective functions, nonlinear constraints where traditional math techniques don't work. Therefore, you have to go to algorithms like the quantum evolutionary algorithms. These are some places where we have published results on these. Then evolutionary algorithms are not geared for constraint optimization. Constraint optimization has to be built into the evolutionary algorithms separately. And the good thing about quantum evolutionary algorithms is that it provides a very broad framework and you can bring in different ideas. So constraint optimization can also be brought in. So what we did was, our main idea is to use a two population approach. Because now we have two requirements in constraint optimization. We want to find solutions with better objective function values, and at the same time, we want to ensure feasibility, in the sense that there should be no constraint violation in the final solution. Therefore, we use two different populations for these two different objectives that we have in mind, and then periodic intermingling of solutions from the two populations, we speed up the search. So this is part of the work done by one PG student and one PhD student. And these are the places where we have published some of the results based on quantum evolutionary algorithms for constraint optimization. So we have initiated some work under the MOU with IIT Delhi. And she is the PhD student who has presented a poster yesterday in the CONSAS 2011 on evolution of quantum circuits. Finding quantum algorithms has proven to be hard. We start with Shor and end with Grover. I beg your pardon. It's not a statement on the kind of work that's going on, but it's a statement on the difficulty of actually finding quantum algorithms. So evolving quantum circuits automatically using evolutionary algorithms seems to be a good alternative, and we're trying that out. And another place where we are trying quantum evolutionary algorithms is test suite reduction, where you have million lines of code that you want to test. The test suites are so large that at Cadence, they have a 3,000 machine cluster that runs 24/7 just doing testing. So the idea was to find algorithms to reduce this computation work. He is the PG student and he is the PhD student working on this. He's also a director at Cadence and working towards his PhD at Dalbagh. So basic conclusion is that quantum evolutionary algorithms are useful. They can be used on classical computers. They can find competitive solutions in less computation time, can be used with advantage for large combinatorial, real function, constraint optimization, variety of problems. But importantly, they can include better initialization, local search, gradient-based local search, any other technique you can merge and make it faster. Also, they are inherently parallelizable. Therefore, you can benefit from the multi-core setups of today that you have. I thank you for your kind attention.